Harper Audio presents The One Life Solution. Reclaim your personal life while achieving greater professional success. Written and read by Dr. Henry Cloud. Copyright 2008 by Dr. Henry Cloud. Production and abridgment copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers. Part 1, Foundations. Chapter 1, Identifying the Problem and the Solution. Maria, the CEO who can't pull the trigger. Maria is the CEO of a tech company and has a team reporting to her that has multiple functions, from finance to marketing and retail. She's ultimately responsible for both the performance of the business and for the culture within the organization. Profits have been good for several years, and because of that, she's been able to hide a problem that troubles her in her more reflective moments. Stan, one of her VPs, is a weak link in the team. She knows it, and so do others. A very nice guy, he's just not the kind of performer that the team needs in that position. The momentum they have experienced keeps the overall picture looking good enough to hide what everyone at that level knows to be true. Stan is over his head and should be replaced. Other team members resent the fact that he's there for two reasons. First, they feel like their efforts are making him successful and thus feel that the situation is not fair. But second, and more demoralizing, they know they could all be at a different level if Stan were replaced. They feel like they are being cheated of what all of them could have if a real star were in his place. So they feel deflated about where they are, resentful of Stan, who's such a nice guy, and resentful of Maria, who won't do anything about him. When I asked Maria why she couldn't fix the situation, she said, "I just can't pull the trigger with him. He's so nice. He's 55 years old, at the pinnacle of his career, and it would kill him. Where would he go? I don't know. I know I should do something, and I have to, but so far, I've just not been able to do it. I just keep putting off the inevitable." David, the manager who can't stand up to a bullying boss. David is a middle manager on an operations team. He is responsible for project management and keeping production schedules moving forward. As a result, he interfaces with many departments and several teams. He likes the complexity of his work, but at the same time, he experiences a lot of stress, as much of what he's held responsible for is out of his control. He lacks real authority over some of the people with whom he finds himself interdependent. His boss, Marion, does not understand this reality and is a bully. He goes off on David when schedules are not where they're supposed to be, berating him and not helping at all. After those interactions, no matter how motivated David was about the work itself, the company, or his own goals, he feels terrible about all of it, and sadly, mostly about himself. He gets sick over the fact that Marion has that much power over how he feels. Unfortunately, not only does it affect him, but David takes it home as well. Too often when he gets home, he's not able to shake their last interaction, and Marion has now entered into David's home and his marriage. Too many nights when he gets home, he's not as available to his wife and kids as he would like to be, as the crummy feelings about his work situation linger. Ryan, the MBA who can't manage his time. Simply put, Ryan is overwhelmed. He does not know how to stop the train, or even how to slow it down. The hours he's putting in never seem to be enough. The projects seem to grow in size and number, and the quantity of it all is beginning to get to him. But that's not the worst part. As an MBA fresh from graduate school, he's accustomed to massive quantities of work. Hard work tires him out. But this is different. This work is wearing him down. Ryan feels as though he spends more and more time and energy on the things he cares less about and less time on the things he loves. There are more meetings and appointments and deadlines, which drain his energy as soon as he sees them on his calendar, than there are activities that energize him. He's finding that most of his time is spent doing things that do little to engage his passion, talent, vision, or even best skills and abilities. This is not why he went to grad school. Similarly, Ryan's personal life feels the same way. He and his wife often fall into bed and collapse. They remark about how it seems they never have time for each other and are not spending time doing the things they love to do together with the people they really love being with the most. Their lives, just as his work, have become a treadmill. His work is part of the problem, too. He's often working on email at night, taking calls at dinner, or checking his BlackBerry when they're out on a date or taking that walk they finally had time for. Ryan's wife frequently asks, "Do you have to do that now?" He feels like he has to, and then sometimes wonders why. His scariest thought is to project his current life ahead for 20 years. He envisions himself doing then what he's doing now, feeling like all he does is work and that it is somehow missing the mark. Sophie, the creative director who can't focus. Sophie has consistently had two parallel responses from her bosses and coworkers. They love her, and they are wowed at her creativity, vision, charming people skills, and her ability to get everyone on board with the newest idea she has spawned. And at the same time, they get more than frustrated with how scattered she is, her lack of follow-through, and the chaos that surrounds almost everything she does. For a long time, Sophie's creativity and all the good things were so exciting and energizing that they kept people on board and glad to be working with her. But lately, the enthusiasm for having to work around her lack of structure and order is growing thin. Her colleagues are getting tired of it, and the negatives have begun to wear them down to the point that they are no longer glad to be working with her. In fact, some gravitate towards projects in which they won't have to depend on her at all, and her boss is getting close to done. Sarah, the assistant who can't confront her boss. Sarah's fun, attractive, outgoing, and very serious about her job. She loves it and wants to please her boss. She's always done whatever he wanted her to do, and more if she could, taking on more work, going the extra mile, whatever it took, and her boss always appreciated it. Lately, however, his appreciation has taken on a different tone. It seems not to be as much about the work as it is about her. He comments less about the good job she did on this task or that, and more about her personally. At first, she thought they were just compliments and they felt good. Sarah liked that her boss thought so well of her. But now, it seems that his comments about her feel seductive, and he's begun to comment less about qualities that affect her work and more about her appearance, personality, and desirability. Sarah doesn't know exactly how to express it, but she now feels very uneasy around him. He's begun to stay around later and later after everyone else is gone except the two of them. She's feeling increasingly uncomfortable. But she also feels that if she were to mention anything, she would be out of line since he hasn't done anything specific enough to which she can confidently point. She just knows in her stomach that his behavior's improper. As time goes on, going to work begins to make her feel sick. Yet she feels like she can't do anything about it, and so she doesn't. Kevin, the salesperson who can't overcome a plateau. Kevin's really smart and likable. Getting his position in sales was not a problem for him, nor was establishing a level of performance that earned him a secure place in the company. When he had been promoted to a regional level after handling a smaller territory, he thought he was on his way. But that has not happened. Kevin has hit a ceiling. Finally, he has to call it what it is, as that's what his boss called it when he told him that Kevin was not going to get the next promotion. He had not wanted to admit that, but now that the words were out there, he knew they were true. He was not getting better. He had hit a plateau in his performance and seemed to be unable to break into the next level. Kevin knew it was possible, as others with whom he had started had made it. But for some reason, his performance has progressed not upward, but in a flat line. Having gone to all the seminars and read all the sales books, Kevin was a little stuck as to what to do. He knew the techniques, the strategies, the tricks, but somehow they were not getting him to that next level. He thought he was smart enough and talented enough, but whatever was wrong was also real. He had hit a wall. The core problem. It would be easy to look at these scenarios and put them into some clear kinds of categories of common business or training problems and prescribe the appropriate training. Management skills for Maria, people skills for David, time management for Ryan, focus for Sophie, sexual harassment training for Sarah, sales growth for Kevin. In fact, there's real value in doing so. Failing to fire the right person is a key management error and begs for leadership development and coaching. Bully bosses are a threat to any culture, and bullied people need help from HR at least. When work increases, time management skills and priority management are vital. Sexual harassment should never be tolerated, and salespeople, good ones, usually can be taught to sell more. Often, when we see scenarios like these, we know something must be done, so we train people in the appropriate business practices, skills, and disciplines that apply to the individual problems that are quickly visible in all these situations. These are important issues to tackle. Take a browse through the business book section in the airport, and you'll likely find good sources to address all these situations with some helpful answers. But is that just treating the symptoms? Is that all there is? Or is there something more or something better you could do? More to the point, if you are one of these people or have one of these issues in your own life, is there something that you could do to be better and not ever be in that situation again? As a business leader once said to me, there's something missing from the way that we do training to fix problems. We give people a lot of content, the what to do in specific problem areas, but for some reason, that does not seem to be enough. A lot of times, my people don't seem to be able to do what the training tells them to do. They don't seem to keep it going past the seminar and the initial enthusiasm of it all. I've seen it over and over again. I agreed. While content training is important, there's an even bigger problem than a lack of knowing what to do. The bigger problem is this. A person still has to go do it. Whatever it is, whether in ethics, time management, or sales, the person is the ultimate piece of equipment, not just what he or she knows. There's a big difference between going to a seminar on anatomy and being able to do open heart surgery. One requires knowledge only, and the other, experience, ability, and character. The page that says cut here doesn't turn you into the person who can pick up the knife and slice someone open to heal them. Maria, the CEO I talked about, knew the VP was underperforming and yet could not pull the trigger. Something was missing inside. So if there's more to rectifying these situations than just the obvious ethics or management training content, what is it? How would each individual turn into the person who can go do it, whatever it is, in each of these contexts? Is there a magic bullet, a path? Yes. There is. The one solution. What if I told you that there's one solution, one issue, that is the central issue in all six scenarios, as different as they all seem? What if I went beyond that and said not only is there one solution to the scenarios, but there's one solution that will affect not only their business problems, but all the other issues that they have in life? And what if there was one solution that made each of them the kind of person who was the same kind of person at work that they were at home or with friends? In other words, what if they no longer felt like they had two lives, but one? Is there one answer that can integrate all of that? What is that one answer or issue that drives all of these other problems? That one answer is called boundaries. In each one of these scenarios, the issue in common is that no matter what their positions, from the CEO all the way to the assistant, the people above had lost control of themselves in one way or another. They all lacked an internal core from which they were able to define themselves and then express that defined self in a way that made life work, while there were 6 different situations mentioned, one issue underlies all these problems: a lack of boundaries. The issue of boundaries is one of the biggest issues that all of us will face in business and in life. Boundaries provide the structure to your character that will make everything else work. Here is the key.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.